Good evening. My name is Rachel Rice, and I'm the Director of Community and UVA Relations here at the University of Maine at Presque Isle, and I would like to commend this audience on its promptness. Usually, when we have a DLS talk or a cultural events talk, we'll have people who are straggling in, but we had people who were here half an hour early for this presentation. And I think that speaks to the presentation that you're about to see tonight. So I want to welcome you to a very special talk as part of our cultural arts programming. We're really pleased to have Jennifer Emerson, a first-person interpreter and historian, join us for this interactive performance and presentation titled Cape Horn Widows, Widows Holding Down the Home Front. Now, I say interactive because Jennifer is going to present this subject from a very unique perspective. During her talk, she'll be taking on the role of one of these Cape Horn widows, I think I have that right, and speaking as if she were that person living in that time. And if you've had a chance to see her, you know she's dressed for the occasion. This is a unique marriage of two different presentation mediums, historic theater and academic lecture. So you're going to see both during this presentation. It's really neat how she can kind of weave it all together. And since we're just a few days past Women's History Month, we're really excited to kind of extend that celebration and have Jennifer focus on an area of women's history that people might not be as familiar with, about the wives of whalers and how they taught sailors to read and write and achieve balance in their personal lives. Let me tell you just a little bit about Jennifer. She's been doing this for 16 years, first-person interpretation, from Connecticut to Baltimore to London, and she's honed her craft in these places. She has presented her work in places like Mystic Seaport to Charles Dickinson's first childhood home in Cleveland Street in London. And I just want to mention, because when we were talking at lunch, she had, I said, how did you get into this business? And she said, well, when I was 7 years old, I saw somebody do it, and I knew that's what I wanted to do when I grew up. And she's very goal-oriented, because by the time she was 24, she was in that place where she saw somebody doing first-person interpretation working in that place. And I just think that's a really neat thing to follow your dreams in that direction. Her first novel is called Dickens and the Whore, and it's a work of historical fiction concerning Charles Dickens's involvement in prostitution reform. It served as her master's thesis and debuted in February 2014. So in addition to all the other things she does, she's a published author. And an especially interesting part of her resume that I want to note is that in 2014 she starred in Firesight Films' award-winning documentary, The Prize of the Chesapeake, as Mrs. Captain Henry Dashiell. She had no lines, but she had to cry on cue for 8 hours of shooting, with her character sorrow revealed only by body language. That's a pretty amazing feat. I can't cry for 8 hours. So I don't think she's going to do that for us tonight. But with that, let us begin. I'd like to welcome tonight's performance and presentation. Welcome you all to tonight's performance and presentation, and thank you for being a part of this special night. Please join me in giving Jennifer Emerson a hearty count of welcome.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's so very good of you to join us this evening for the weekly meeting of the American Seamen's Friends Society, the Portland branch. Indeed, our numbers are growing, thanks be to God. The Reverend has done remarkable work, has he not, in bringing all of you here. But of course, you're here for other reasons. Many of you, including myself, we have loved ones across the sea, separated by great distances. And yet, there are sailors coming into our town all the time. The port is overflowing with them, whalers, fishermen, all sorts. Who but us, the good people of this town, and us ladies too, the nurturers of the home, the instillers of good, moral, decent values. Who better than we happy few to help this wretched outcast of society, sailors? Do you know, I've never understood, and perhaps you feel the same way, why sailors have become so frowned upon. Did our Savior not socialize with fishermen? Was Peter himself not a sailor? Have you ever found that odd? We shall have to ask the Reverend about it, I think. But before we read the minutes, and I assure you we will, our secretary has been very diligent, I would, if the present body will indulge me, wish to relay a tale which occurred about a fortnight ago. We were seated here within the reading room, a few of us sewing. One lady still clad in black, her husband gone less than a year. And a young man walked through the door. Sweet-looking young man, about 16. He had his hat in his hands, holding it very sheepishly. And he stood at the door, reluctant to enter. And so I rose and bid him welcome. Come in, young man, how are you? Please, sit down. I introduced the present company and myself, Miss Margaret Hines. How may we help you? You are among friends here. Do you know there were tears in his eyes? His hands were leathery and calloused. I could tell he was a topman. The fronts of the tips of his fingers had been so worn from reaching over the yard and furling bits of big pieces of cloth, furling the sails for so long. I could tell through his young ears this was not his first time at sea. And he looked at me and he said, "Ma'am, my shipmate said that you could help me, but I don't know if I should have come here." And I said, "Of course, young man, you should come here. Please, sit down and tell us how we can help you." And so he did, but his shoulders were slumped the whole time. And he took from his pocket a crumpled letter. And he said, "Well, when we was in Lahaina a couple months ago, we got a sack of mail off of one of the ships, and it was for us from home. And one of my shipmates said that this was for me, but I can't read it. Will you help me, ma'am?" And I took the letter from him and said, "Of course. I'll read it aloud to you. Do you mind if my friends stay?" "Oh, no, ma'am, that'd be fine. I know I'm among fine folk here." Well, we read the letter to him. It was from his mother, telling him how proud she was of him and that she was praying for his safe return. And at that point, we were all weeping. And I put my hand on his and I said, "Why don't we compose a reply, shall we?" And his tears continued even further when he said, "But ma'am, I can't write. And I miss my mama so bad and I don't know how to tell her. Will you help me? My shipmates, they laugh at me. Please help me. I don't want to be a whaler the rest of my life, having no money. I want to save up. I want to buy a plot of land. I don't even know how to manage a checkbook. I'm here because I want to learn." And so his education began that day. And through the next week, I told him, "If you meet me here every day for a week," that's how long his ship was in port, "come here every day for 2 hours, I will give a note to your captain. I will teach you to read and write, and by the time your ship puts out on Friday, you will at least be able to write your name. The next port you go into, find the reading room, I'll give you a letter, and the ladies there will continue your education." Do you know, he wrote back. And he has composed his first letter home to his mother by himself. Is that not wonderful? And such is the great work that we do here, we volunteers of the American Seaman's Friend. We'll adjourn this meeting for now for refreshment, and when we come back, our secretary will read the minutes. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm Jennifer Emerson, and welcome to Cape Horn Widows. So you just met a typical 1840s woman in a seaport town. And what we're going to do through the rest of this talk is get you a little more acquainted with what the ladies were doing. I don't mean those kind of ladies. I mean the respectable ladies. We know what the men were doing at sea, and we'll refresh your memory on that just a bit. But what we're really going to focus on is the importance of the woman's contribution to the American Seamen's Friend Society, which was a non-for-profit group solely for the benefit of a group of people whose society would have otherwise looked the other way. So let's get started, shall we? In order to understand the importance of being a Cape Horn widow, which is the term used for women who were married to sailors, because of course sailors are gone all the time. So it's like being single. So you were married yet single. You were a Cape Horn widow. So not only were actual widows called this term, but also the sweethearts of whalers as well. You were called the Cape Horn widow. Involved yet single. Did I mention how long a whaling voyage lasts? Does anyone know? 2 to 5 years. That's a long time. So to that end, before we start the slideshow or the PowerPoint, I'd like to take a tip from Gary and show a little bit of a classic film. 5 points if you guess which one it is. No? Yes, Moby Dick. The good one with Gregory Peck. Oh, he was good looking, wasn't he? I'm not going to watch the whole thing, but I just want to show you one clip of the film, once this kicks in here, that illustrates what we're going to talk about and the importance of it. Now, my laptop is about 1,000 years old, so it might take just a moment for it to work. Here we go.
Hoist the arms! Up and close the door!
many of you have seen this film? Yes? Oh, I see some hands up. Oh, very good. That film is the reason I'm standing here tonight. I saw it when I was 7, and then my parents took me to Mystic Seaport Museum, where I beheld the whale ship Charles W. Morgan for the first time, the last wooden whale ship left in existence. And it was an instant love affair, but what fascinated me more was the story that I wasn't seeing on board the ship. But when we went into one of the rooms called the Sailor's Reading Room, a replica, may we have the lights, please, of the Seaman's Friends Society, just some is fine. There was a woman sitting there in 1870s clothing, and she was portraying, we're going to start this slide in just a minute, I wanted people to see me. She was portraying a captain's wife, and she was so convincing to my 7-year-old brain that as we exited the building, I told my mother, that's what I want to do. So that film is the reason we're standing here, and that's the reason that I like to use it, because it really shows, John Huston really went to in great detail to show the anxiety of separation between these people. And so I hope you enjoyed it as well. The look on the women's faces, it's really quite touching. And did you notice how the women walked on the quayside? They walked alongside the ship as they were kedging her out, the Pequot out of the dock, until quayside ended and they couldn't go any further. They walked right up to the front. It's very touching. So, in order to understand the women's contribution, we'll briefly touch upon what the men did. Let me come over here so you can see. It's not going to work. Well, that's all right. Let's try it this way. And if we have to do it the old-fashioned way, that's fine. Looks like we're going to have to. All right. No. Here. So this is a map of most of the major seaport towns up and down the eastern coast of the United States. And whaling was a huge industry. It didn't matter if you lived along the coast. It still impacted you. And what species were they hunting? They were species specific. Primarily, there were three: the bowhead, the bright whale, which have very thick blubber, so they yield a good quality oil, and it was the oil that they predominantly wanted. And also the sperm whale, which was considered the highest quality oil, never mixed with any other kind, and it was used in the lubrication of intricate gear systems, clocks, watches, jewelers, lathes, things of that nature. So even if you were a lady sitting at home using your brand new Singer sewing machine, which came in the 1840s, you needed whale oil to keep it going. If you wanted to see in the dark, you needed whale oil. If you worked in a big factory and you wanted those, you didn't want those gears to rub and catch friction and cause an explosion, you needed whale oil. So everybody was benefiting from it. From atop the ship at about a 90-foot height are the lookout hoops. It's an iron hoop with two little slats of wood, and sailors would climb up there and you would spend 2 hours at the masthead looking for whales. And if you saw the spout on the horizon, these men were so good that from the pattern of the spout, they could tell what species of whale it was. They were very good, and they'd shout down 90 feet down to the officer on watch, "Whale, oh, there she blows! There go flukes! Flukes gone down!" And they would ask, "Where away? How many? What kind? How far off?" And the officer would say, "Lower the boats!" And they would go out in a little 30-foot boat with 6 men against a 60-foot, 60-ton whale. That does not make sense, if you ask me. But that's what they did. They would approach the whale from behind using stealth. The officer in the stern would command the harpooner in the bow to put down his oar and dart your iron, thrust the harpoon into the hide of the whale. That harpoon is connected to 1,000 feet of line coiled in the boat. Now, if the whale is very unhappy, he might just turn around and make itty-bitty toothpicks out of your boat. People in the 19th century could not swim, so this was a worst-case scenario. However, most of the time, being peaceful creatures, the whale is simply going to take off along the surface of the water, clocking speeds of about 30 miles an hour. It was known as the Nantucket Sleigh Ride, fastest ride of its day. So as the whale tires out, they're going to pull on that rope, work their way back up to the whale, and dispatch it. After that had been done, then they have to go back up and approach the whale because they have to attach it to their little boat. And you can see the mothership in the background. It's not on fire, but that is what the they're trying to get back to. That's the furnace, the tri-works, where the blubber is going to be rendered into oil. This was like a factory at sea. And this was their worst nightmare. Not backing up from that whale in time could send you right down to Davy Jones's locker. But once they got the whale, they called that the whale's revenge, by the way, having to tow the whale back. And they hunted those specific species because they float when they die. And the ship was not capable of holding the whale up. Nowadays, from the Greenpeace videos, we do see that, these poor creatures are brought up. The bow opens and the whale is brought up. They didn't have the technology to do that. The whale stays in the water. And so they basically did what you do when you peel an apple or an orange. They took it off in circular strips. Cut it off into smaller and smaller pieces and put it in this brick furnace, these in cauldrons called the tri-works. So cutting in, getting the blubber off, and then trying out, rendering the fat into oil. It was then cooled and placed into casks and stored in the hold. And that is the end product of what you're trying to get home with. They would probably go through about 30 to 80 whales per voyage. And we wonder why they're endangered today. It was a necessary evil in those days. Thank goodness we live in an age of technology where we can flip a light switch and we have WD-40 and all the things that they didn't have. But putting it in within the context of the time period, it was a very dirty, disgusting, nasty way to make a living, and they thought so too, but it was a job. And it was a job that required no background check and no prior experience necessary. They would take any Johnny off the street. Here's a wider shot. This is the wharf at New Bedford. And again, all of those are full of whale oil to light the lamps of the world. This is a bottle of whale oil, still capped, from, I believe, the 1840s, from the Nye Company in New Bedford, Massachusetts. It is specifically for sharpening stones and jeweler's lathes. So it's a really fine example of something that's left from that time. But we women were in on the whaling trade as well. It wasn't just the men. This is not a tropical island, and those are not palm trees. Would you like to guess what they might be? Any better?
Not banana trees?
They look like banana trees, don't they? No, they're not. They're not trees. Have you heard of a whalebone corset? No. Those are stacks of baleen. It comes from the upper jaw of non-toothed whales. We call it baleen, they called it whalebone. They didn't really know what it was. It's keratin, it's what your nails and your hair are made out of. And it's actually how they catch microscopic food through the ocean. It's actually how they eat. You can't imagine something that big eating something this little, but they do. And that would be harvested as well. And it's flexible. You can bend it into certain things. So whalebone corsets. I actually am wearing a corset, although the struts are steel, they're not whalebone. But the women were in on the whaling trade as well. We benefited in a fashion sense from this. And just like today, women and men were expected to dress and look a certain way. And if you didn't, you got the full brunt of your fellow men. And these things were also made, crafts were also made by the sailors at sea. This swift in the lower right-hand corner was made by a whaling captain for his wife out of pan bone, which comes from the jaw of a sperm whale. Done by hand. It's a beautiful piece of work. On the lower left, you see what's called a busk, and it has a love poem on it. They would carve hearts and flowers and all sorts of frilly things in it and give it to your lady lover, your wife back home, and then she would actually insert this busk into the front of her corset, and while you're separated by great distances, she would keep you close to her heart. Isn't that romantic? It's very sweet. So here are some typical ladies. You may look familiar. There's some typical ladies of the 1840s. This is a fashion plate from August of 1844. So whaling is doing a great deal to make them look as good as they do. Also, the ambergris, which comes from the gut of a sperm whale, was used in the making of perfume. Anybody know what these are? Want to take a guess?
Yes.
Huh? What's that?
Is it Scrimshaw?
It is Scrimshaw. Yeah. Does anybody hear fake?
Yes.
These are pie crimpers. Just you roll it all the way around to crimp your pie. And then the fork to poke a hole in the crust. Yep, just roll it all the way around to crimp the pie. handmade, again, not by professional artists, but by men who had a lot of time on their hands at sea. The captain would insist that you keep busy. Why? Because if you don't, you're going to focus upon how far from home you are and how much you miss your loved ones, and then you're probably going to get yourself into some nasty trouble. And that was not good for anybody. So busy work was an essential part of shipboard life. My favorite were the Valentines. So you're traveling the world's oceans. Remember, you're gone 2 to 5 years, and very often you actually did circumnavigate the globe during this voyage. So you're pulling into all these different ports in these exotic places of the world, and you're trading and bartering for all sorts of wondrous things. And you might see these shells of beautiful colors, and you're collecting them, and then you think, well, gee, what am I going to do with these? I'm going to make something for my mom, for my wife, my girlfriend, whoever it might be. I want to give them something when I come back so that they see the worth and they see that I'm thinking of them. And every time, even though we're separated, every time they look at that, for that brief moment, we'll be reunited. It's really a beautiful thing. And if you don't think the women back home were wearied, they were. Not just the actual widows, but all Cape Horn widows. This was their worst nightmare. These men could not swim, and if they couldn't reach out for a floating piece of debris, it was down to Davy Jones's locker they went. But also weather conditions were a concern, including hurricanes and storms, but also being lost in the Arctic. As the whaling population became decreased, they started to go into the Arctic, and twice the American fleet did get stuck in the ice. The first time, thankfully, no lives were lost. In the centennial year, however, fatalities were confirmed by Christmas. So what to do? Well, as many people do today, they turn to their faith for solace. This is the Seaman's Bethel in New Bedford, Massachusetts. If you've read Moby Dick, this is the Whaleman's Chapel. If you go there, you can actually see the pew where Herman Melville attended a service. It's marked with a plaque. Anybody here read Moby Dick? You have? Very good. Okay. There will be a quiz at the end. if you're ever interested, Mystic Seaport does a marathon reading of Moby Dick every year, starting July 31st through August 1st, which was Melville's birthday. And I don't know if they do it anymore, but they used to let you camp out on the Charles W. Morgan, on the whale ship. And they have a fellow who plays Melville and recites the entire first and last chapter from memory. I don't know how he does it. It's quite extraordinary. So if that's something you'd be interested in, call Mystic Seaport and see if they're doing it. The lower level of this church, it is still a functioning house of worship, weddings, christenings, church services. The lower level of this church is actually a reading room, almost like a fellowship hall. It's almost as large as this room. And it played a crucial role in the education of sailors within that town, and we'll get to that in a little while. But within Moby Dick and within the film that I just showed you, if you've seen it, this is one of the most iconic shots of Orson Welles as Father Mapple. Turn to chapter 9 in the novel, and it is the sermon. And what does he preach to the crew of the Pequod? The story of Jonah. And even out of the belly of hell, grounded upon the ocean's utmost bones, God heard him when he cried. And out of the shuddering cold and blackness of the deep, the whale breached into the sun and vomited out Jonah upon the dry land. He did the Almighty's bidding, and what was that, shipmates? To preach the truth in the face of falsehood. And eternal delight shall be his, who coming to lay him down can say with his final breath, O Father, mortal or immortal, here I lie. I have striven to be thine, more than to be this world's or mine own. This is the actual interior of the Whaleman's Chapel. It's a 19th century image. You'll notice one thing missing. What's missing? The pulpit. This was shot on a soundstage. But when the film premiered in 1956, people were flocking to New Bedford to see the chapel. And guess what? There's no pulpit. So they took matters into their own hands. They built a fiberglass pulpit. I've had the honor of speaking from from that pulpit. It's a great privilege, and it's a wonderful church. And if you go to the marathon reading of Moby Dick in New Bedford, which they do in January, because it's when Melville actually went to sea, when they reach chapter 9, they actually go into the church and do the sermon in the church. And it's just wonderful. Many consider that sermon to be the most beautiful sermon ever composed in the English language. So getting back to the women, you see a whole group of people who you know rather intimately. They're your father, your boyfriend, your husband, your son. And you see that society largely doesn't give them a second look, as I said. But they're human beings. They're worthy of dignity. They're worthy of bringing up, just like anybody else. So what's a girl to do? Well, you put your heads together and start forming a plan. So if these men are coming into town, what do they need? They need respectable lodging, an empty, good food, place to get a decent bath, religious instruction, education, learn how to open a bank account and manage it wisely. Learn how to invest and maybe buy some land one day so you don't have to keep going to sea. But there's no reason you can't have a party every now and then with respectable people, dances, Christmas, Thanksgiving, inviting them home. And correspondence. We didn't have the benefit of Twitter and Facebook. You couldn't text your mom and say, "Hi, I'm in Honolulu, everything's fine." But you could go to the local reading room and write a letter, just like our young sailor did right here in Portland that I told you about. So who better to do this than we ladies, the upholders of everything moral and decent within Victorian society, the teachers, the nurturers, the comforters, the mothers, the wives, the grandmothers, the ones with experience and wisdom, the ones who can handle any crisis in a home, and also the ones who manage the house in their husband's absence, including menus, finances, correspondence, sometimes running a husband's business in their absence. Who better than the women to roll their sleeves up and take care of these sailors? Not just their own relatives, but whoever crosses the threshold. No one else is going to. And if you want society to improve, get there on the ground and help. And that's what they did. And this man was instrumental in helping them, Richard Henry Dana. He was a sailor himself, and if you really want to know what it was like to be a deep water sailor in the 1840s, read his book, 2 Years Before the Mast. It is mind-blowingly accurate. And there are parts of it that will shock you. But he makes no bones about the fact that these men had no legal recourse, no representation, no one to help them. Frederick Pease Harlow in the 1880s wrote a memoir called The Making of a Sailor. And by then, things really hadn't changed. Floggings, tyrannical captains. Melville didn't make it up. It did happen. When you're at sea, the captain is the boss. That's rule number one. Rule number two is get used to rule number one. Finally, we have the incorporation of the American Seamen's Friend Society. An actual, established, non-for-profit organization that is solely designed to benefit sailors. This is a typical membership certificate of the society. Charles W. Morgan, who I mentioned earlier, and for whom the whale ship is named, was a member, an active member of the American Seamen's Friend Society. So it wasn't just the women. It was retired whaling captains, business owners. They all got involved. The idea caught on. So what is their motive? Well, the missionary work among seamen actually dates to about 1814, but it takes decades for it to actually become an organized institution. Dana helps by publishing a book, a treatise. Why did he do that? So that people can become acquainted with this group of people. Particularly whaling, but sailors in general, it was a social clique. In fact, they looked upon other groups of people rather disapprovingly. Particularly farmers and soldiers. You know why? They get to sleep in their bed at night. They have steady wives and girlfriends. And their house doesn't move all the time. And so if you saw a sailor loitering about on the deck, one of his shipmates would go, "Hey boy, quit your soldiering. We ain't farmers here. Quit your soldiering. Get out and find some work to do." And those were derogatory comments. Now, nowadays, you, "Hey, don't call me," but in those days, it was a different story. So it wasn't just a one-way street, but farmers and soldiers had institutions to help them, had families to help them. Sailors are largely on their own. So we can understand maybe why they were slightly jaded. And this is the goal of the American Seamen's Friends Society, to improve the social and moral condition of seamen. That's it! We're going to provide religious instruction, we're going to teach them how to read and write, we're going to teach them how to handle their finances, and help them better their lives. That's all they wanted to do. So in order to understand the mindset of the women whose job it is going to be to man these institutions, these portside reading rooms, as they were called, these places of higher learning, we have to get into the mind of what ladies were actually being taught. And I came across a book, the fifth edition is from 1838, it's called Letters to Young Ladies. And this has a fascinating chapter on knowledge. Knowledge is valuable for the pleasure it imparts. I love that. We often forget how much fun learning can be. And I'll have to say, attending a few classes today, Umpi certainly understands that. That learning is fun. And these women wanted it to be fun for these men as well. If you're going to put in the time, it might as well be enjoyable. Learning doth make the mind gentle, generous, and pliant to government. Ignorance leaveth it churlish. Lord Bacon put it very well. Sincerity, this is one of my favorite quotes, is to speak as we think, to do as we intend and profess, to perform and make good what we promise, and really to be what we would seem and appear to be. In modern vernacular, walk the walk. Be who you say you are. We would say today, be your authentic self. We think that's a new concept. It's not. It was alive and well in the 19th century, and here's the proof. You're going to have a Shakespeare performance here very soon. I was going through my Hamlet, and Polonius says to his son, to thine own self be true, as it must follow the night the day, so thou canst not be false to any man. By the way, Shakespeare was often taught to these men as a way of getting them to understand modern concepts. They would quote it to each other quite often. True politeness, charm, to which every nature is susceptible. True politeness requires three things: humility, good sense, and benevolence. All the things that make up the American Seamen's Friends Society. General Nathaniel Greene, hero from the American Revolution, put it very well. Learning is not a virtue, but the means to bring us an acquaintance with it. Very, very true. Let these be our motives to action through life, the relief of the distressed. And sailors certainly were distressed. The detection of fraud, the defeat of oppression, and the diffusion of happiness. So why is all this important? I need a volunteer. Who, oh, who could be my... Oh, hello! Come on, Hannah. Come on. This won't hurt a bit, I promise. Okay. For the next 5 minutes, your name is Jack. Now, prevent I'm not dressed in this finery. I'm the shipboard owners there, the fellow holding the books and all of that stuff in the film. Pretend I look like him and I've got a beard. Well, how are you, son?
I'm good.
Okay. What's your name?
Evan.
No.
Oh, Jack. Don't call us, we'll call you. Jack! That's all right. Jack, you live close by? Yeah. Do you want to go to sea? Yeah.
Sure.
What are you, a farmer or something? Never been to sea before? No.
Soldier.
Soldier. Well, pardon me, it's dusty in here. All right. Well, that's fine. You look like you got a good strong back there. Now you ain't never killed nobody, have you? Only in the line of duty.
Yeah.
Never murdered nobody.
No.
Never. Been in a fight every now and then?
Maybe.
Maybe?
Okay.
You're a religious boy? You believe in God? Read the Bible?
Yeah.
You good at taking orders? You're a soldier?
Uh-huh.
We see your hands. Well, they'll callous up, that's fine. All right, well, I'll tell you, well, let me get my book. And here's a pen. So if this particular ship, the Tiger, she's leaving in about a week's time. Is that enough? Uh-huh. That's gonna be probably about a 2-year voyage. You understand you ain't coming home. For 2 years. That's all right? Once you sign, you got to do it. All right, well, walk here, you take, well, go ahead and sign your name in the ledger. Hold on, wait, stop, don't. I like you, Sun Coon. You remind me of my own boy. Now, don't. I was going to give you about 1/25th of the total profit, but don't tell anybody. You and I are going to be pals. I'm going to give you 1/60th of the total profit. That sound good? All right, sign, make your heart rate, can you write? You're going to make your heart. All right, thank you very much. We'll see you in a week. All right, God bless you, son. Applause for our young woman. Thank you, very well done. Thank you. You saw what I just did to him, yes?
Yeah.
Happened all the time. When your math teacher says you're going to need this one day, they mean it. Saucy Sally, that was a term for those ugly, very, very friendly women who lived in a certain part of town. And I'll tell you a very funny story that happened to a lot of these poor boys. They would go into these taverns and have a rootin' tootin' good time, but didn't realize that their beer was being spiked. And they would all of a sudden feel kind of dizzy. And one of these ladies would lead them upstairs. And then all the whole world would go black and you'd wake up with an aching head, either on board a ship because you've been shanghaied, or in her room. Your clothes gone, your wallet gone, your watch gone, everything gone, and you've got to get back to the ship. And there are records of these men running lickety-split through the town, up the gangway, onto the ship in one of the ladies' dresses. And don't you think that their shipmates never let them live in town? So you see now why an education is kind of important for these guys? You know, knowledge is power. Know your fractions, you won't get taken advantage of. And one thing that these women understand, because they are the teachers and the nurturers of their own children and families at home, we think of this as a modern concept, but it isn't. These women understood very well that success is a process, not an event. Cultivation of a fine garden takes time. You can't plant a rose bush and say, grow! You can't do that. You have to cultivate it, give it what it needs, give it patience and time, prune it when appropriate at certain times of the year. And when you do that, when you put in the effort, you get a beautiful product that blooms and gives you joy for years to come. Women understood that. But there was a catch. This is a temperance pledge. I see some of you going, oh no. It wasn't required, but when you came into one of these places, chances are you're going to make conversation with a fine lady dressed this way, and at some point, she's going to bring this subject up. Now son, think of your mother. Think of your poor wife at home. How can you go into these places knowing that you might be taken advantage of? You could be shanghaied, or worse, you could have your goods stolen and you could wait. We won't go into that, will we? Don't you see the importance of taking care of yourself? When you take care of yourself, you're taking care of your loved ones back home. And they can get a decent night's sleep knowing that you are taking care of yourself. Now sign this pledge and write to them, I beg you, and tell them that you've taken the oath. Now, as Mr. Dickens put it, we're talking the total abstinence principle. No booze, no girlfriends, no chewing tobacco, no stealing, no fighting, no getting in trouble. Does that sound like fun? No, it doesn't. And there were a lot of men who said, well, son, you go on in there and have fun with those teetotalers if you want to. I'm going down to the tavern. Yeah, I'm not wanting anything to do with those psalm-singing little prigs. Thank you very much. There were a lot of them like that. And I'm sure a few of them regretted not taking them up on the offer. He didn't have to sign the temperance pledge. This particular sailor did. I wonder if he actually kept his pledge or not. We'll never know. Or you might just sign it to impress the pretty lady sitting in front of you. Who knows? I'm sure they did that too. But this, when we say sailor, is the image that we all have. Come on, admit it. Yes. Jack Tar whooping it up in the tavern with some pretty ladies, the music and the beer is flowing. This one is the dirtiest one I have, I promise. This young lady adjusting her shoe with, if you look in the gutter, you'll see the point of contention. Oh, talk about having your mind in the gutter. If you'd like like to know more about the slide after the talk, please approach me. So sailors' homes come in, a decent place to lodge. And if you lived in a seaport town that didn't have the money to build a lodging house, you would contract with the local boarding houses. If you came to the reading room and you needed a decent night's sleep in a respectable place, the lady there would write a letter, and you'd bring that to the keeper of the boardhouse, and they would give you room and board. It was that simple. This particular one is on Purchase Street in Boston. Getting back to education, how are they going to get hold of all of these educational resources when they're at sea? Sometimes they're only in port for a week or a fortnight, which is 2 weeks. How do you complete a lesson, an education, in such a short time? Well, you don't. The answer was the lending libraries. These small cases were locked, and the key was given to the captain, and they were filled with all different types of books that were donated to the cause. Every subject you can think of, from romance novels to popular literature of the day, Washington Irving, Edgar Allan Poe, Charles Dickens, you name it, William Makepeace Thackeray, Anthony Trollope, Bronte, they were all there. Books on mathematics, ciphering, spelling, grammar, primers, books that a child would use in order to learn to read and write would be tucked in here. Because why not? Books on history, politics, geography, anything to give them a well-rounded education, something for everybody. And so, at certain times of the day, well, I should tell you that a sailor's day was 4 hours on, 4 hours off, around the clock. That's not a lot of downtime. And so sometimes, between 4 and 8 p.m., that particular four-hour watch or shift would be cut in half, what they called dogging the watch. So that meant you had 2 free hours to do whatever you wanted. And during the dog watch, you might sew up a hole in your trousers, or you might knit yourself a new cap. It's something that these men did. You might skylark, climb into the rigging just to get away from everybody else for a while. There's 22 men in a crew. After a while, you're not going to be able to stand the sight of each other. You need to get away. Or you might gather around with some of your shipmates and read to each other, or help each other with your ciphering. Help each other write that letter home. They did that, and there are records of them. There are records of sailors sitting in the forecastle, in the crew's quarters, having constructed a quilting rack and getting scraps of fabric from old shirts and pants that they had. And one guy saying, well, I remember my Aunt Rosie had a quilting rack in her parlor. And another guy said, well, let's make one. And they did, sitting around, smoking pipes, chewing tobacco, making a quilt. It happened. These women were paying off. They were rubbing off on these men. It was happening. And they had the opportunity to contribute back. So publications like the American Seaman's Friend's Sailor's Magazine, the Whaleman's Shipping List, the Merchant's Transcript, which was a New Bedford newspaper that came out every Tuesday. These particular publications catered specifically to sailors. And a lot of the whalemen offered their own tall tales, their sea stories, their testimonials of conversion to faith, or just of general gratitude to the institution. And they contributed articles that were published within these papers, within these magazines. So imagine this, just some Johnny ordinary nobody who's just a sailor. And in the eye of society at that time, pretty much meant you were a nobody. Having your words published in a legitimate publication, a public publication that people are going to read. That's profound. And that's the impact that these women were making. And it spread to the United Kingdom, among other places. They called it the Mariner's Friend Society. Different ports in London, Hull, Tilbury, Manchester, all sporting what they call reading rooms. We use the same terminology here, and book deposits. Constantly getting different donations of books, time, money, all from ordinary citizens, saying, you know, maybe these sailors aren't such bad people after all. I did a little digging since I was coming to Maine, and I found a little information about the Portland branch of the American Seaman's Friend Society. The first Seaman's Church in Portland was constructed in 1828, organized formally in 1840. The church was erected at 4th Street. Now, I've never been to Portland. So maybe some of you know where that is. They built a sailor's home in 1855 at the corner of India and Middle Street. I saw some people shaking. Do you know where that is? Yeah? Okay. Is the building still there?
I don't remember the West.
Okay.
But I know the street is that there.
Okay. All right. Well, that's where it was. Formally organized in 1865. And their mission was quite simple. Promote the temporal and spiritual welfare of the seamen of Portland. Sounds like a good idea to me. Take a look in the eyes of these men. They've seen things no one should ever have to. They have a haunted look in their eyes. But the thing that unites them is the fact that they have been through it together. We few, we happy few, we band of brothers. And this picture so poignantly represents many of the facets that the Seamen's Friend Society, and particularly what the women were able to give them. The organ, religious instruction, music, dancing, the gramophone, popular music of the time, appropriate diversion, a bountiful table, good food and drink, camaraderie, fellowship, brothership, and particularly above the back door, the very warm phrase, come again. If you feel welcome in no other place on God's earth, my boy, you are welcome here. Now and forever, this is your home. And every reading room they traveled to around the world had that same phrase, this is your home. And the camaraderie among these men lasted well after whaling careers had died out. This is the Jaboom Club, the first branch of which opened in my hometown, New London, Connecticut, which was a whaling town. The Jaboom is a particular piece off the bow of a ship, and they thought that was a good name, so they formed the Jaboom Club. They had a place where they met, and they would get together and have a pint and smoke some cigars and relive their glory days. And they would march in the local parades. They would make floats and such and have their harpoons and everything, because they didn't want people to forget their contributions to culture, economics. They hadn't forgotten. They didn't want anyone else to forget either. They were proud of what they did because it was hard to do. If it wasn't hard, everybody would have done it. It was hard, soulless, drudgery. It was dirty, it was disgusting, it was oily, it was bloody. The food was terrible. They worked like dogs and lived like pigs for very little. But they worked. They weren't afraid to work. And because of their efforts, the lamps of the world were illuminated. Because of them, the chrism oil to anoint was produced. Because of them, your sewing machine worked, your pocket watch worked, the clock on your mantle worked. And they didn't want you to forget that. Women were not just making contributions in reading rooms and in parlors. Some of them actually went to sea. The only person in the crew that could bring their wife was the captain. The company had to approve it, but some were in favor of it. Charles W. Morgan himself said, and I quote, "A ship is more humane with a woman aboard." It was catching on. So, what to do? Well, think of it this way. Here I am. I'm pretty puny. I don't eat much. I don't know the mainsail from the jib. I'm not going to get in your way. I'm the boss's wife. I understand that you are working. I'm going to keep to myself because I know that this deck has a lot of lines and I don't want to get my ankle caught in it. And I don't want to distract you from what you're doing because I want to get home as quickly as you do. But I will be your friend and I will put in a good word for you with the captain if you need it. Other than that, I will not bother you. I understand that this is your professional workplace and that I am the intruder. And that was their stance. Now, let's say that this young man, or this young man, does something he shouldn't, and the captain gets himself into a right tizzy and he's ready to flog the hide off him. Now, the first mate can't go walk up to him and go, "Would you lighten up?" But his wife can say, "Now, dear, I knew you when you were that age, and you were just as stupid as he is. boy alone. Can't you punish him in a less severe way? He's just a boy, dear. Now come, show some compassion. What would our Lord do? And of course he would, well, all right, I'll let it ride. But don't do it again. You think that these young men are not going to praise that woman to the skies? Of course they are, and they're going to bend over backwards to please her, because in pleasing her, they please their boss, and a happy boss is a happy workplace. Yes? And in return, she's going to make sure that you have a treat every now and then. Or if you're ill, and you're in your bunk, or you're on deck in a, they actually would build little cabins on the aft deck for the captain's wives. And if you weren't feeling so well, she might let you actually lie down in there and put a cool compress on your head and hold your hand and say, that's all right, you're going to be fine. Don't worry, young man. It's all right. Hush now, you sleep. I'm right here, and I'll take care of you. Just like his mom would. And at holiday time, there are records of these women sewing, hand sewing, 25 little bags and filling them with popcorn as a gift. Sometimes offering them each a fresh jar of preserves. And in turn, those men would make toys for her children at Christmas time or birthday and play with them. So it became very much a family atmosphere. Now, there were those sailors who, behind closed doors, would say, you know, shipmate, this vessel's turning into a real hen frigate. It's really not a nice thing to say, and you never said it within earshot of the captain or his wife. But they might, in fact, consider it a hen frigate. Oh, she's coming along? Oh, great. A mouth to feed that doesn't do any work. Oh, look at that. Two mouths to feed that don't do any work. Three. Oh, just my luck. And there were those who felt that way. But in the larger sense, most of the men were grateful for the wife's presence for the reasons that I mentioned. Eliza Brock accompanied her husband on the whale ship Lexington, home of my heart and friends adieu, lingering beside some foreign strand. How oft shall I remember you, how oft o'er the water blue, send back a sigh to those I love, the loving and beloved few who grieve for me, for whom I grieve. These women were quite brave in their decision. There were many people back home who shunned them, but they said, my darling husband, if the sea shall be your home, it shall be mine. I will not be separated from you for 2 to 5 years anymore. Our children are growing up without knowing you. It's not right, and I won't stand for it. I will put up with the cramped conditions, the smells, the terrible food, the seasickness. I will gladly bear it all to keep our family united. Please take us with you. And they did. Mary Brewster is from Stonington, Connecticut, very close to where I grew up. She's one of the more famous captain's wives who went to sea. And she wrote it this way in her diary. Oh, what is there which will fill this aching void? Nothing but the presence of the dear object of my heart and affections. He is truly the bright star of my affections, the center of all my thoughts. Well, thank heaven it is all past. And I am on board the good ship Tiger, and with my dear husband. These women kept amazing journals that have actually been published. There's a very good book called She Was a Sister Sailor that has many of these journal excerpts in it, and I highly recommend it. So far from being just the hopeless and helpless damsels of popular fiction, these women proved that they were of stronger metal, using maternal instinct, all of the social norms of the 19th century that they were expected to uphold, and did that and exceeded in it by imparting those morals and education to sailors, a group of people that nobody cared about. But people did have a sense of humor in those days, and this is my favorite cartoon from a New York newspaper celebrating the discovery of petroleum oil in the ground of Pennsylvania in 1859. And word, apparently the whales subscribed to the New York Tribune. And really good circulation getting it down at the bottom of the ocean. And they held a beautiful dance, a ball. They had a wonderful party celebrating the decline of whaling. And a lot of people didn't think it would happen, but there were people with enough foresight to say, you know, getting oil out of the ground is a lot easier than having going out for 2 to 5 years and killing whales. This is apples to oranges. It doesn't take a genius to figure it out. But actually, whaling in this fashion did not die until the 1920s, so it took time, but the death knell was already there. And so these whales are celebrating. The banners are particularly funny. My two favorite, we wail, W-A-I-L, we wail no more for our blubber. And my favorite, oil's well that ends well. This is the Charles W. Morgan on permanent display at Mystic Seaport Museum. She is the last wooden whale ship left in existence. All of her hundreds of sister vessels have since either sunk or been broken up. She is truly a treasure. I had the honor of working aboard her for 11 years. I know her from all the very top to the very bottom. And she's quite something. And reading the stories of the women, five different captains' wives ventured out to sea on this particular vessel. And their contributions were amazing. One of them even helped as assistant navigator on board the vessel and made entries into the ship's journal, into the log. It's astounding. Just by being themselves, look at what they were able to accomplish together. With, for no other reason, no set agenda, they just wanted to help. They saw a need and they tried to fill it. And that really, in a certain way, is the key to success. They had no expectation. They just wanted to do their best. And they left a lasting legacy. And this is my information, and it's been an absolute pleasure to bring this topic to you. And so I'll salute you with a final curtsy, and I'm happy to take any questions at this time. Thank you. You did. Wonderful. Oh, that's wonderful.
It just brings back a lot of memories.
Oh, well, I'm happy to be the bearer of such good memories. That's great. Thank you. Thank you very much. The place holds good memories for me, too. Yes. Anything else? Hi, Gary.
Hi. I don't know if you ever noticed this, but that excerpt you showed of the movie, one of the characters, I forget his real name, but I recognized him. He played Bob Cratchit in the 1951 version.
Mervyn Johns, yes.
Yeah,
Welsh actor, yeah. Yes, isn't he wonderful? He was a real chameleon. He could change from role to role. It's hard to think that the first time I noticed it, I went, that's little cravingly Bob Cratchit. No way, but that's a character.
The Alistair Sim is my
favorite. Oh, me too, absolutely, yes. Yes?
How old is the dress?
My dress?
Yeah.
This is about 10 years old, but it's based on what somebody in about 1848 would wear. Mm-hmm. And it's actually kind of comfortable, which I'm really happy about. Want to see my shoes? Here, I'll go with your shoes. Gentlemen. That's all you're getting. Yes?
Well, it was the Friends Society. Is there any relationship with the Quakers?
There are a lot of Quakers who were involved, absolutely. Yeah. Yes, in fact, the ship owners that you saw in the film clip were Quakers. Mm-hmm. They were very involved, absolutely.
Yes.
I think they do. Not particularly within the American Seamen's Friend were they doing that. To my knowledge, I've never read it. They might have, but I've never found a source. Else? Ask whatever you want. We'll start back here.
Okay.
Yes.
Can you clarify the network by which the temperance ladies
distributed their literature. These ships weren't constantly at sea for days they put in. And so as you were speaking, I was curious about, I'm sure not every port had a temperance lady unit there waiting.
True, that's true.
But
thankfully, just
could you speak to that? Their network.
Their network, yeah. A lot of times, what basically happened was that a temperance movement would just join up with a local Seaman's Friend group if they had it. If they didn't, then the Seaman's Friend was going to initiate that conversation on their own. But pretty much in every port, by the mid-19th century, temperance is really catching on. And in fact, a lot of people in the United States and in the United Kingdom are suffering from malnutrition, particularly the poor, because the nutrients gained from drinking beer are not in tea. And so that actually, in certain respects, was making people more ill than what, because beer, yes, it will get you loopy, but it's got nutrients in it. Tea does not. But
outside of
the sailors?
No, outside of the British Isles and the other ports of call where?
I wouldn't be able to speak personally to any place outside the U.S. or the U.K., but I can't. That's not true. They did have them in South America.
Okay.
And also certain branches of the Seaman's Friend Society were even in Lahaina and Honolulu. Valparaiso,
yeah.
Talcahuana, places like that. And so it does start to, I guess we would call it international appeal. It does start to spread. But specifically speaking, within each port, you're basically going to take what you have and work with it. So if you had a temperance movement, they would join forces with the Seaman's Friend Society. And if you didn't have a Seaman's Friend Society, hopefully you had a temperance movement or vice versa. There are records of, in fact, we used to reenact this at Mystic Seaport, of sailors running down the street with a woman chasing them holding a temperance pledge. Wait a minute, you said you'd sign this, get back here! Get back here! They would, they'd chase you, which is quite funny. Yeah, absolutely. I hope that answers your question. Okay. Just one more. Yeah, I'll come right to you. Okay. Yeah. Okay, go ahead.
I was wondering about if there was a Me Too movement back then in some way, like how there was sexual harassment of any kind, say when these sailors would come
and
take a shining and kind of overact their thing, like I suppose the Me Too movement reports today. But
I have to say that's always been a question that I have thought of, particularly playing these types of women. And I can honestly say I've never come across a written source about there ever being an assignation within one of these reading rooms. I'm not saying it didn't happen, but most of the time the ladies would not be there alone. You would have a retired captain or somebody else there. You would have a male presence, whether it was the preacher or whoever it might be. And so my thought would be that would deter anyone from coming in. And also, why go and bother those ladies when I can just go to the other part of town and readily acquire what I'm looking for? Yeah, but no, that's not, I think that's a very valid question. And also when I discovered that these captain's wives were going to sea, I thought the very same thing. I said, my goodness, isn't that a little dangerous? So 23 men on board this vessel? And then somebody put it very nicely and said, no, my dear, she's God's wife. They're not going to mess with her. So, no, but very insightful. Thank you.
I was wondering about the whaling business.
Yes.
Did they just get one whale or two to have one on each side of the ship?
They would
or
kill one at a time.
Or did the back end open up and
no, they would actually process the whale, which took 24 hours just for one whale, working around the clock. They would process one whale from the side of the vessel and bring the pieces of the whale on board. And then when they acquired everything from the carcass that they wanted, they would simply cut it loose and let the sharks take it. Yeah.
Did they consume the meat from that?
Typically, no. There are certain cultures that do, but particularly the American whalemen did not find it palatable. And also, if it's taken, remember, they're doing a lot of this work in the Pacific. And so by the time you tow this animal back and you've processed what you need, the carcass is already starting to rot. And so you're not going to be acquiring that meat. They did have meat on board. It was salted. Or they would fish. They did that. They ate a lot of porpoise, shark, different seabirds as well. If you could kill it, they would do that as well.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but no, they didn't eat the meat.
May I have one more question?
Certainly.
Did they sell their product in other ports that they stopped at?
Typically, no, they would bring it back. So a whale ship was very much like an oil tanker, and so your cargo came back. When whaling voyages got longer and longer and they were in the Pacific, when they, railroad had gone through the entire country, they would sometimes offload and ship some of it back to New England by rail. Guys, can we wait just a minute for this young lady? Okay, go ahead.
How many whales did they kill?
How many? In one trip, about 30 to 80 whales. That's a lot, yeah. And now the vessel that I showed you, the Morgan, that picture of that really pretty ship, she whaled for 80 years. She had the longest career of any other whale ship. Normally they lasted about 20. She whaled for 80 years. In fact, I met someone who saw her come in for the final time when she was 5 years old. And she told me that when the Morgan came back in, that everybody ran inside the house and grabbed napkins and sheets and tablecloths, anything, and they went out to the dock and they started to wave. And she said, I'll never forget it. I looked up at all the grown-ups and they were And she said, Auntie, why, she was with her aunt, Auntie, why are you crying? And she said, because it's the end of an era. Mm-hmm. It meant a lot to them. To what we look at whaling now and we go, oh my God, that's such a terrible thing. And it was a terrible thing, but it was a necessity in those days. And I hope that I've shown you that within the presentation. These people, not only the men were proud of what they did, their women were very proud of what they did. Okay, guys, go ahead.
Well, as you said, just now, it was the end of an era. What happened after the discovery of oil, and what happened to these institutions, the women that donated their time and the salary?
The women who donated their time simply went back home. And a lot of them became teachers, school teachers themselves. By the end of the American Civil War, a lot of these school teachers were now women because the men had gone off to war. And that often happens when men are gone, whether it's a war or whether they're gone to sea. It's the women who come in and step into those roles. If your father is a blacksmith and he's off at war, guess who's going to run the shop? You and your sisters. So that's basically what happened to them. You also had sailors' homes, which were sort of like retirement homes. And so the women would often donate their services there, offering spiritual comfort, taking care of people, writing letters for them, that sort of thing. But largely, they just went home.
Was there any compensation for women, or people just donated time?
They donated their time. They gave up their time to a cause that they believed in. Yeah, the notion was, I'm doing for you, you young man, what I hope someone in a far off part of the world is doing for my son, for my brother, for my father. So they consider it a very fair and even trade. And whaling itself, it took until the 1920s for this type of whaling to die out. More and more what was happening is of course petroleum came in, and so that is now fueling our need for oil at the time. And it's just too long and too arduous a process to continue to go and catch these creatures solely for oil. It just isn't profitable anymore. And a large part of what they're doing is they're going up into the Arctic and hunting primarily the bowhead and the right whale for that baleen, for that whalebone, because they still need those products. And also, if you'll forgive the notion, they are starting to go seal hunting as well for the pelts. And so they will, they're changing. They're still going out to sea, but they're changing tactics. They're changing what they're doing for profit. Because remember, you're on a company-owned ship and you've signed a contract, and if you don't follow through, you don't get paid. It was a very brutal business. Absolutely. Anybody else? Anybody? Yeah?
So you mentioned temperance, the temperance girls. The main law, which is also called the main liquor law, was in the 1850s, and that was one of the first legal prohibition laws.
Okay.
Did that influence the tolerance?
Yep. Prohibition comes as a direct result of these types of efforts, and the two very much did work in tandem with each other. It's funny, my own grandfather, during Prohibition, made peach brandy for the chief of police and the fire marshal where he lives. Yeah, absolutely. Thank you for sharing. I didn't know that. Anybody else? Yes?
Well, did you
you do on the Charles Morgan?
What did I do? I was an interpreter just in plain clothes. I would answer people's questions about the ship. I did actually climb up into the rig and handle the sails. I went all the way up to the lookout hoops and would shout, "There she blows." And I participated in the mock whaleboat demonstration where we would show how the little whaleboat works and how you would approach the whale. So I was able to do all
that. Do they still do those?
They still do those, yes. And it was always gratifying when you heard from the deck, "Look, Mommy, it's a girl." I thought girls didn't do that. And so we would tell them when we came down, "Well, we don't, but we're making up for lost time." That was always fun. I missed that. Anybody else? Another one? Okay.
Were the people sad, were the wife sad when they had to...
Yeah, they were very sad, very, very sad. And that's one of the reasons that they started helping other people was that, I don't know if you've ever heard this phrase, if you get nervous, focus on service. If you're feeling really down and depressed, the best thing that you can do is go and help somebody else because it makes you forget about your troubles and it shows you that there are other people who have it worse off than you and they need your help. So it doesn't do any good to sit there and just be sad. You have to get out there and help people. And that's what they did. Good? Well, you've been a delight. Thank you, Rachel. Thank you, Nancy.
Thank you.
Oh, I'm going to enjoy this.
And just one more.